Hello everyone, welcome back to my reinforcement learning course. This is our fourth lecture. We will introduce value iteration and policy iteration algorithms. This is the map of our course. In the last lecture, we introduced the Bellman optimality equation. In this lecture, we are here. This is the first time in our course that we formally introduce algorithms that can find optimal policies. Today, we suppose that the system model is known. In the next lecture, we will introduce algorithms that do not require the model. These three lectures are very closely related. The first algorithm, value iteration, which we are going to introduce today, was actually introduced in the last lecture. But today we will present it in a more formal way. Another algorithm we introduced today is policy iteration, which actually lays the groundwork for Monte Carlo learning, which will be introduced in the next lecture. This lecture covers three algorithms. First, value iteration, second, policy iteration, and third, truncated policy iteration. Later, you will see that the three algorithms are closely related. In fact, value iteration and policy iteration are two extreme cases of truncated policy iteration. This will become clear later. First, let's talk about value iteration. In the last lecture, we already introduced the Bellman optimality equation, whose matrix vector form is like this. I hope you are already familiar with it. If not, it's necessary to go back to the last lecture to learn it first. Otherwise, it will be very challenging to understand the algorithm today. Let's revisit how we solve the Bellman optimality equation. In the last lecture, we introduced the contraction mapping theorem. This theorem tells us that just by using this algorithm, we can find the optimal policy and the optimal state value. It's an iterative algorithm where the right-hand side is vk and the left-hand side is vk plus 1. Actually, this algorithm has a name, value iteration. Next, we analyze this algorithm in detail, including how to implement it in programming. As for why this value iteration algorithm is designed this way and why it can find the optimal policy, these questions have been answered in the last lecture. So, we don't need to answer them here again. Let's look at this algorithm. It consists of two parts. The first part is given vk. I need to solve an optimization problem to find pi. Once pi is obtained, we can solve vk plus 1. So this corresponds to two steps. The first step is called policy update. It solves the optimization problem on the right-hand side. Then I can get pi k plus 1. The second step is value update. I can substitute pi k plus 1 here, and then based on vk, I can get vk plus 1. So next, we further analyze how to implement this in programming. But before that, let's answer a small question. Is vk a state value? At first glance, it seems like vk is a state value because it's in such an equation. But if you look closely, the right-hand side is vk and the left-hand side is vk plus 1. If the left-hand side were vk, then it would indeed be a Bellman equation, and vk would be a state value. But the left-hand side is not vk. So this is not a Bellman equation, and vk is not a state value. It can be any value, and may not be a state value. Next, I will introduce the details of this algorithm and then present its element-wise form. It's important to mention that we often use the matrix vector form for theoretical analysis. However, when we want to understand how it is implemented, we need to look at its element-wise form. Let's take a closer look at step 1, policy update. This is its matrix vector form, and I need to solve pi k plus 1. How exactly do I do it? In fact, for each state s, I can derive such an equation. I believe everyone is very familiar with this. The right-hand side is vk, and the preceding components are known. So by substituting vk, I can obtain qk. How do we solve the optimal policy then? We have also introduced this in great detail in the previous lecture. The optimal policy will choose the action that corresponds to the highest qk. We denote this action as ak star. Then, the probability of all other actions is zero. Thus, this policy is a deterministic policy, and it is also a greedy policy. It simply selects the greatest q value. The second step is value update. This is its matrix vector form. For each state s, we can write out its element-wise form. Similarly, from this vk, we can solve for qk. Just now we obtained pi k plus 1. We can substitute it in. The result will actually be very simple because the probability in pi k plus 1 for taking the action that corresponds to the largest qk is 1, and all others are 0. So the final vk plus 1 is just the largest qk. Now we summarize the entire process. Let's look at this process. I start with vk. Initially, vk can be v0 or v1. From vk, I can calculate qk. Once I obtain qk, I immediately know the greatest qk and its corresponding action. Then, I can obtain the greedy policy pi k plus 1, and I can also obtain this vk plus 1, which corresponds to the greatest qk. This process can be written as this pseudocode. Let me briefly go through it. First, I have an initial value vk. When this vk has not yet converged, convergence means the difference between vk and vk minus 1 has not decreased to a very small number, like 0.001. If it's less than a very small number, we say vk has converged. If not, we do the following. Suppose this is the kth iteration. What do we do? First, we traverse all states s. For each state s, we traverse all its actions and calculate qk for each action. After calculating qk, it's very simple. First, we just need to see which action corresponds to the largest qk. Then, for the policy update, I just update the policy to choose that action. For the value update, vk plus 1 is the largest qk. Now, let's use an example to demonstrate how to apply this algorithm. Here is a forbidden area, and this is the target area. Our task is to find an optimal policy using the value iteration algorithm we just introduced. There are some basic settings for this example. What are these two on the right-hand side? They represent the policy pi k plus 1, obtained during the iteration process of using this algorithm. I've illustrated it here and you will see how it was derived later. First, when using this algorithm for policy search, what should I have? When you give me this v, I should be able to calculate this q. So, there's such a thing as a q table. Of course, when programming, it's not strictly necessary to have such a table, but you should be able to calculate Q from V. Let's look at the first step where K equals 0. I initially select V0. V0 is a value that can be arbitrarily chosen. For simplicity, we choose it to be 0. Then I substitute this V0 into the Q table. We have all the states here and all the actions here. With this table, what can we obtain? First, policy update. For example, for state S1, I want to know which Q value is the largest. We can see that this one and that one are the largest. The corresponding actions are A3 and A5. So, what is my policy? Since I have two actions corresponding to the same largest Q values, I can choose either. In this case, for S1, I choose action A5. Similarly, I look for the largest Q value for other states. Accordingly, I choose A3 for S2, A2 for S3, and A5 for S4. Then, the corresponding values for the second step, value update, are these maximum QKs, which are used as the new V1 for the next step. We can visualize this policy. Turning back to the previous slide, we see the policy can be plotted like this. In states S2, S3, and S4, the optimal policy has already been reached, as we already know what the optimal policy looks like. However, in state S1, it is not the optimal policy. It remains to stay still by the present policy, but the optimal policy is to move downward. Don't worry. Next, we can do more iterations to generate the optimal policy. At k equals 1, the previous iteration gives us the value of V1. We substitute these values back into the Q table, resulting in a new Q table. Then, immediately, for each state, we can see which Q value is the largest. This Q value is the largest, so its new policy is to choose A3, and its new value is this. The new policy A3, the new policy A2, and then the new value is this value. The new policy is A5, and the new value is this value. These are the two steps. Now let's take a look at the new policy. Returning back to the previous slide, what does this policy look like? It's shown like this. We can tell that this is already the optimal policy. This means that with just two iterations, we've already found the optimal policy from a random initial policy. This example is very simple. If the example were more complex, it would require more iterations. Then we could continue to iterate further. When do we stop? When the difference between vk and vk plus 1 is sufficiently small. This means that no matter how hard I try beyond this point, I won't be able to make significant changes. That's when we can stop.